In this video, I'll help you finally understand pointers in C++. The video is split between three levels: beginner, intermediate, and advanced, so there is something to learn for everyone. So if you are an absolute beginner, don't worry if you don't understand the intermediate or advanced parts yet. You can rewatch this video for those parts later. For now, you just need to learn the basics, and I made the beginner section as easy as humanly possible, so let's go! I remember when I was just a beginner, and I would hear people say that pointers are difficult and dangerous. And that led me to falsely believe that they are hard to understand. I remember a friend of mine telling me that for him C++ is too difficult to use, and that he doesn't understand pointers. But now, for real, they are not that difficult, and some of you will probably hate me for saying this, but there are way more advanced topics in programming. So if you aren't able to understand this simple concept, you won't get far. So let's fix that today. Beginner level. You probably know that the CPU is the thing that does mathematical operations in your computer. If I gave you to do this simple addition, you would be able to do it in your head, right? Well, what if I gave you something like this? You can solve it, but you probably need to write it on a whiteboard or something. This is exactly what the CPU does. He writes things into what is called RAM. The RAM is the whiteboard of the CPU. So these variables will be stored somewhere in his whiteboard, and the CPU can just look at them and use them to make his calculations. And this is a good analogy, because like you, the CPU can store some numbers in his head and can do some calculations in his head. But if there are too many numbers, he has to use the whiteboard to look, write down some values, or remember some other values. Also, because the whiteboard is not unlimited, whenever some values are not needed anymore, some other things will be written on top. Okay, now here come our pointers. Imagine this is our whiteboard and we want to store some values here. We can get more organized and draw a grid to place our values in. And we'll just number each cell. This number is called its address. If I told you to give me the number inside the cell at address 3, you will look for the cell with the address 3 and find out that the number inside it is 69 lmao. And these addresses are basically pointers. They are just a number that represent the number of a cell inside the computer's memory. And every number our computer stores is held somewhere inside the cell, and that cell will have an address. Now you might be wondering, why do we need pointers when we assign names to our variables? Well, the variable names are just for us. For the computer, they will actually just be converted into pointers. Okay, so let's take a look at some code now. I will create a variable. Here I print it, but I will use this symbol to print its address. This operator gives us the address of a variable. Let's run it. This address is the address of the cell where our variable is. It is a weird number, but that is because it is written in hexadecimal format. That's just another way of writing numbers, and we can convert it to a normal number with a tool like this. Looking back at our whiteboard analogy, we have this cell that has the value of 69 inside, and the cell has this address. The address is very big, because there are many cells to store values inside our RAM. Next, we have this code here. We have our variable called a, and it is equal to 69. But then we create another variable called b, but with this syntax. This star here means that this variable is a pointer, and it is a pointer to an int. So it stores an address, and we know that that address is to a variable of type int. In this case, this variable holds the address of a. Remember that this symbol gives us the address of A. So you have these two new symbols to remember, and you might forget which one is which, so pay attention once again. This means address of, and this means that we are declaring a pointer. Looking at our whiteboard analogy, we have the variable A here in cell number 3, and B is also somewhere in our whiteboard, in another cell, and it just holds the value 3, because 3 is the address of A. Note that B also has an address of its own, and we can also get that address, but we'll look at that in the advanced section. Now, let's look at another example. I will add some new variables to our code, and I will also put them on the whiteboard. Now, try to fill them with the correct values. So first of all, C will just be equal to 420. Next, D will hold the address of A, and that is 3. Next, F will hold the address of C. We take a look at that, and the address of C is 8. Finally, G will just have the value of A, not the address of A, just the value. So we write that. We can also modify where a pointer is pointing to, like so. But finally, let's do this. If we use this star symbol again, we can modify the value of the variable that B is pointing to. This is called the referencing. So we are not modifying B, but actually we are modifying A, because remember, B points to A. So A will now have the value 100. So this is the power of pointers. They allow you to refer to other variables and modify them. We'll look at interesting patterns later. Okay, so this is basically how pointers work. You also have to keep in mind that you also need to use the right data type, as you can see here. So as an exercise, try to predict what this example will print, and then also type the code yourself and check if you get your answer correct. Now let's move to the intermediate level, and the concepts here will be explained slightly faster. I have a function here that takes a parameter and it doubles it. If I write this code here, what do you think will happen to our variable? Well, it turns out that nothing. And that is because parameters are just copied. So this function will just take a copy of our variable. But it is a different variable, so it can modify the original. Now, what if I take that parameter as a pointer? Well, now I can modify it. This is because the pointer holds the address of that variable. So we modify the value at that address, hence modifying the original variable. These are the two functions compared side to side. Look at this code. Nothing special, right? Well, what if I do this? Well, let's analyze it. You probably know that an uninitialized variable just holds some random data. Looking at our whiteboard analogy, it is the data that was in that cell before we used it. It turns out that the CPU is lazy and he's not wiping his whiteboard. He just writes new values on top. So this pointer will just hold some garbage values that points to some address, God knows where. And if we run this code, it will crash our program. You also need to keep in mind that pointing to a value 0 is considered invalid, and this will also crash your program. A pointer with the value 0 is special and is called a null pointer. And it has its own type. It is useful because you can always check if your pointers are valid by checking if their value is different to 0. Except cases where they point to garbage, of course. But this allows you to, for example, have optional parameters in your functions. I use this pattern very often. So this function will load some textures for my game, and I optionally take a pointer to some error reporter struct. If I don't pass null pointer there, it will use that struct to report errors. Speaking of structs or classes, so I have here a pointer to a struct. How can I access its members? Well, you need to use the star operator to dereference it. And then we can access its members, but this looks ugly. So C++ gives us a shortcut that looks like this. So these two lines here do the exact same thing. Okay, now C++ also gives us another tool called a reference. This behaves like a pointer, but it can't be changed. It also can be null or undefined. So this is how I can reference a variable and change it. So these two pieces of code do the same thing. Since references can be null, you can use them where you need, for example, to modify the parameter of a function. And you want to be sure that the user passes something valid there, since it can be null or undefined. And this is called passing by reference, while this is called passing by value. You can see why. Here I am just giving the value of my variable to the function, and as we already discussed, it is just a copy. Here I am giving a reference to my function, and I can modify it. Now, memory allocation and smart pointers would be worth covering here. But this video is already kinda long, and I don't use smart pointers personally. So if you want to see a similar video on the topic of memory allocation and learn about why I don't use smart pointers, let me know in the comments and subscribe to not miss that video. And I also have other interesting C++ things on this channel that you might find nice to watch. Next we have to talk about arrays. Arrays in C++ are actually just pointers undercover. But let's see how that works. I have this array here. The array will have all its elements in order in the whiteboard. So it will look like this. The array variable itself is just a pointer to the first element of the array. So I can do this. And also this. What do you think this will print? Well, it just prints the first element inside the array. So this also means that if you want to pass an array to a function, instead of messing around with the syntax, you can just ask for a pointer. Just make sure you also ask for the size or something. Now, remember when I said that pointers are just numbers? Well, let's add one to this number here. What will this code give us? Well, let's take a look at the whiteboard. The array just holds the value 7. If we increase it by 1, we get the value 8. Looking at our whiteboard, the cell numbered 8 points to the second element in our array. And indeed, if we run this code, we can see that we get the second element inside the array. Now, typing this is kinda ugly, so C++ gives us a shortcut. Looks familiar? In fact, these two lines are equivalent. Now, fun fact, if we start from here, and we know this is equal to this, and then we rearrange the terms, we get here. This actually, surprisingly, is equivalent to the first line here. Okay, now I oversimplified this thing here. So, let's get into advanced section. To be fair, there are not many really advanced things regarding pointers, as in very difficult, but there is stuff to cover regardless. Before we look at pointer arithmetic, let's talk about some simpler things. First, we'll see this pattern a lot. You might remember that I said that functions will copy your variables when you pass parameters. And if you have a big structure, that might take a lot of time to copy. Or if you have a container that actually has a custom copy constructor that will allocate memory. So people do this to optimize. Nowadays, however, this thing is relevant only if the thing you are passing is actually big. And structs that are 16 bytes long, like this one, are not big. I'm talking things that are way bigger. The reason is that the compiler is actually smart enough to do some optimizations. For example, the calling convention allows something like 48 bytes of parameters to be placed directly inside the registers, instead of the stack. That's like 12 ints. Plus, pointers mean that the compiler can't optimize the code to store data inside registers, because the value at that address could potentially change. So it needs to continuously fetch that from memory. But I'm oversimplifying things here. Now, these things are getting difficult. You can look into the restrict keyword in C, for example. In practice, you need to measure to know the performance difference. But for things like this, I think that there will be no difference. So I just pass small structs by value. And small structs include things like for floats. Also on this topic, please stop doing this. I see many people that come from languages like C# into C++ and just start to allocate things on the heap for no reason. Doing this has many potential drawbacks and no benefits. I was talking with a friend about this, because I saw him doing this pattern, and he told me something like, well, I might copy the data inside the struct by mistake. But copying data doesn't take that much, especially for small structs like this. And I don't think you will actually copy a big struct by mistake. But even if you do, that is probably better than the problems that memory allocations can get you. So my rule of thumb is don't allocate stuff on the heap for no reason. Allocating memory is a choice that always has some drawbacks, so you can't just do it if you don't have a reason. And the code looking good or clean is not a reason. And design patterns are not a reason. It might look good, but it doesn't run better, and most importantly, it is not easier to maintain. So don't do it. Unless, of course, you have a real reason to allocate things on the heap. But I will make a separate video on the topic of memory allocations if you want. So let me know down in the comment section. Okay, next, let's quickly talk about const. So you have all of these possible cases. I know it is a mess, but don't worry, the rule is simple. The const can either be before the star, or after the star, or both behind and in front. So there are actually only three cases. Before, after, and both. Now, if we look at these three cases, they're actually all the same. Because const is before the star, and it makes no sense to have const two times here. But it is a valid syntax, for no reason. So putting const before the star means that you can't change the pointer to another address. But you can't modify the content inside that address. You can remember this by thinking about a const char pointer. This points to some read-only text. So you are not allowed to modify the text, but you can point the pointer to some other text. And now, if the const is after the star, it's the other way around. You can modify the thing pointed by the address, but you can't move the pointer to another address. And of course, if you have const both behind and after this pointer, you can't modify anything. Okay, now two more things and then we get to pointer arithmetic, I promise. So first of all, pointers can be used to make this nice pattern, where you want to have something applied to a variable. But you don't know yet what variable to pick. So you can just put that value in a pointer and then at the end act over it. This can also be done with function pointers, where you don't know yet what function to call. Yes, there are function pointers. They behave how you'd expect. You can make a pointer to a function and call it. Their syntax is kinda ugly, But I will show you a trick. You can just use auto to declare a pointer to a function. And if you hover it with your mouse, it will tell you the syntax for the pointer to that function, if you need it. You're welcome. Okay, this one might be a little tougher. Pointers to pointers. So let's say that we need to pass this int by reference. We want to modify it. Well, no problem, we can just pass a pointer. Okay, but what if we want to pass a pointer as a reference? Because we want to modify it. Well, we have to make a pointer to a pointer. And it's not that bad actually. You can blindly add a star here, and to modify it, you just, well, dereference it as you did before. Now, pointer to pointers can come in handy when you want to store an array of arrays. Because, well, a pointer to an int can hold an array. So a pointer to a pointer to an int will hold an array of arrays, to ints. The concept seems hard at first, but you can get used to them if you play around with them a little. I will give you a tip here. The type system in C++ will actually catch errors here. So if you get compile errors, don't get mad. It actually means that you are doing something wrong. So fix it. Don't do force casts. That will just crash your program. Finally, let's talk about pointer arithmetic. So the size of our variables matters. An int is typically 4 bytes. A long, however, depends. Yes, I know this is horrible. And things are like this because C++ comes from C, and C is an old language that needs to run on any device. There are fortunately fixed size types, like these ones. Finally, a char is probably always 1 byte. Now you might ask yourself, what size is a pointer? Well, it needs to be big enough to fit all of the possible addresses. So for a 32-bit architecture, for example, that means that it is 32 bits or 4 bytes. And if you do some quick math, you'll realize that a 32-bit computer can only hold 4 gigabytes of RAM addresses. And that's true. For a 64-bit computer, that means 8 bytes and a ton of addresses. So this code returns something different for each architecture. If you want a variable that is exactly the size of a pointer, you can use sizeT or ssizeT if you want it to be signed. Okay, now the size of the cells inside our whiteboard is 1 byte. So that means that you can only fit 1 char inside its cell. If you want to fit an int, you will need 4 cells. So if we have an int called A, a pointer to A will point to the first cell of this variable, and there will be 4 cells that make it up. If you make an array of ints, it will look like this in memory. So now you might be wondering, why did the array example work? Like, adding 1 to this pointer will just advance the cells by 1, and that won't bring us to the second value inside our array. Well, this is where the type of the pointer comes into play. The type of the pointer will tell the compiler how many bytes to read when dereferencing the value, and it will also tell it how many bytes to advance when adding values to it. So this code actually does this under the hood. So let's look at an example. We have an int, and we take the address of it. Then we cast that to an unsigned char pointer. Then we dereference it. This will tell the compiler to basically read only the first byte of our variable. Finally, we can cast that value into an int, because cout prints characters if you pass a char to it, and we want to see a number on our screen. And we can do this for each byte inside our variable. So, since we cast this to unsigned char pointer, adding 1 will advance the pointer 1 byte. Now, if we print this, you will see something weird. You probably expected the number to be stored like this. But if we print the numbers, we get this, hinting that the bytes are stored in reverse. That is because modern computers use what is called little endian. And it just means that they store the numbers in reverse. It doesn't really matter to the user. I recommend you to play around with other values here to understand it better. For example, 256 looks like this in memory. So if we run this program, we get this. You can try to play around with other numbers yourself. The idea is that you can mess around with pointers in this way. And you, of course, need to be careful what you're doing, but it is useful. Let's say you need to send an int through the network. I have a networking tutorial if you are curious. But basically, imagine that you have a function called sendData. It takes some data to send and a size. So I can just call it like this. Note that I take the data as a void pointer. And a void pointer is just a wildcard. It can be anything, and it has no size, so you can dereference it. And you can do pointer arithmetic on it. You can cast it, however, to whatever you want. Like in this example, I am getting the value of this float, and then I am reading it back as an int. Interesting. I now have a function called receiveData, I just get the data, and I convert it to an int. Now it is very important that I know that this data is an int. If you mess this up, and you dereference a null pointer, your program will crash. Where if you read the data as the wrong type, your program won't behave as you want, or it will crash in the best case. But you just have to be careful, and it can work flawlessly. In my multiplayer Minecraft clone, I had to do this to send and receive data through the network. And you can see that I have a way of correctly determining what the current data type that I get is, and I also double check that its size is correct. So let me know if you would like to see a video like this on memory allocation or maybe virtual memory, or maybe talk some more about bit manipulations. Until then, share this video and maybe check out this full game in C++ guide of mine. See you there!